Hello everyone, this is Mario. Welcome to my channel and to the fourth episode of my Groupama FDJ career in Pro Cycling Manager. So we're starting this one coming from the Arabian Peninsula, where we had really strong results in the Tour of Oman and in the United Arab Emirates Tour. In both races combined, we got a total of 6 stage wins and also several jerseys. Arnaud Demare won the points jersey in both races, and also I had the mountain classification with Rudy Mollard in Oman and with Thibaut Pinot in the Emirates Tour, so it was a quite productive stay in the Arabian Peninsula. And so we are now going back to Europe to officially kickstart the classic season. So in this episode I will start by riding the Omloop Het Nieuwsblad, and then I will be heading to Italy for the Strade Bianche. And to finalize the episode, I will probably ride the first 3 stages of the Paris-Nice, which is one of the first top objectives of the team for the season. So as I said, this is the official kickstart of the classic season, more specifically of the Northern classic season, and as usual, the first race is Omloop Het Nieuwsblad. This race has several cobbled sectors spread along almost 200 kilometers, and in these cobbled sectors we include the famous duo of the Kapellmoer and the Bosberg. So we are going to ride this one with Stefan Kung and Marc Sarre as the top riders in the team, and they are actually considered among the top 10 favorites for the race. It's not going to be easy to win it, because in this race, although many of the best classic riders are not present, we have one of the world's best in this type of races, Wout van Aert, who is by far the top favorite. And so we are now starting the race, 193.5 kilometers. Marc Sarre is on a +2 race day condition, so that is really great. It's going to help him a lot in this race. And unfortunately, Stefan Kung is on a 0 race day condition. But well, I think this will probably make Marc Sarre as my top leader for the race. Still thinking about Stefan Kung as well, of course. And I won't put any of my riders in the breakaway. I will try to work from the peloton with the riders I have. And let's see how this goes. And so with already 40 kilometers completed in this race, we have a breakaway group of 6 riders, but they only have less than a minute over the peloton. The pace back in the peloton is really high. They are not letting the riders in the front go away. And in this group, we have Alexis Vuillermoz, Alex Dowsett, also Vandenberg, Ivo Oliveira, Victor Campenaerts. So some nice riders, not the strongest riders in cobbled races, but it's still an interesting group. And the peloton really doesn't want them to go away. We now have Jumbo Visma pacing with Nilsson Paulus. So let's see how this goes in the next few kilometers. And so the breakaway riders were brought in, and I think I'm maybe going to try an attack now. Let's see if this works. Let's go with William Bonnet and see if before the first cobbled sector is allowed to go away. I don't really know if the peloton is interested in that, and apparently he's the only one attacking, and the peloton is going to let him go. So being alone in the front, it's not going to be that amazing. Let's drop his pace a bit so that he can gain a bit of an advantage, but not waste too much energy. And so now I'm going to try to put Sinkeldam in the front of the race as well. So I will try to attack with him now to join up with Bonnet. So he's being allowed to go by the peloton. Let's see if this can work out, and by having two riders in the front, if they can work together and maintain in the front. So let's hope this strategy is a good one. And so we are now roughly 35 kilometers from the finish. We still have Sinkeldam and Bonnet in the front, just about 40 seconds ahead of the peloton, and still no major attacks coming out from the favorite riders. Soon we will have the Kappelmoor and Bosberg, so let's keep the riders in the best position possible in those two climbs. And so we finally have some attacks. Some riders like Matej Mohoric and Marco Haller are trying to attack. Let's keep here for now, and they will soon catch Sinkeldam and Bonnet. They are just ahead, only 13 seconds ahead now, but I still have Stefan Kung and Marc Sarre in good positions and in good condition. So let's see how this goes. We now have Jumbo Visma in the front of the race, I think. Also De Kunik. No, it's not De Kunik Quick Step. But yeah, mainly Jumbo, and we have an attack by Capio. He's trying to go alone, and no response from the peloton, but I'm having Bonnet and Sinkeldam pacing at the front. And so here we are, arriving at the Kappelmoor. Let's see how we do. Marc Sarre is in the lead. I'm using the effort cursor 90 to really keep him at the front. He's doing well so far. We can actually maybe drop this a bit, or let's maintain position at 95 for now. And Stefan Kung is trying to get to the front. He was dropped a bit, and he's dropped. He's in the group behind, but Marc Sarre is in the peloton. This is only a 13 rider group. It's not a peloton. Let's see if we can bring back Stefan Kung there. Let's try an attack and bring him back to the front. Marc Sarre is still being protected by Duquesne, and we have Stefan Kung back here. So let's see. We are now on the Bosberg, and Marc Sarre is still looking good. Let's try to take him to the front. Wout van Aert is going really hard now. Oh, Stefan Kung is being dropped again. He was dropped once more. And Marc Sarre is going to be left behind, I think. He's together with Debuchere. Let's see if we can work together here with Debuchere, and Stefan Kung is really far behind now. So let's try to relay a bit at 90. In the front we have Matej Mohoric and Wout van Aert with 9 kilometers to go. As expected, van Aert is the clear favorite to win this race. And so we have now Stefan Kung pulling in this group with Marc Sarre on his wheel. We are getting close to the finish line, and still almost a minute behind Wout van Aert. Matej Mohoric is just behind him, and we have some attacks now. Let's start to pace harder with Stefan Kung, and now let's go at 95 with Marc Sarre. Let's not sprint yet, and let's do it now. Can we take third place with Marc Sarre in this one? And Marc Sarre is going to be third behind Wout van Aert and Matej Mohoric. So it's a really decent result in this one. Van Aert made the attack, made the final attack, and took the win. He managed to go solo until the end, 22 seconds ahead of Matej Mohoric. And so this was a really nice race. I think a podium finish with Marc Sarre is a strong result. I also got Stefan Kung to finish in ninth. And considering this is the first race of the season for Stefan Kung, it's really not a bad result. And so, one day after the Omloop Het Nieuwsblad, we rode the Koern Brussel Koern, and we took Stefan Kung and Marc Sarre again as the team leaders. This time I failed on the podium. I got only fifth with Marc Sarre. It's a decent result. He was in the final group, the final 18 rider group that sprinted for the win. He wasn't the strongest, but it's still a nice result for him. And so now, the team will travel for the first time in the season to Italy. We are going to ride the Strade Bianche. So for this one, I will be taking Rudy Mollard as the team leader. And depending on the race situation, I may eventually think about Anthony Roux as an alternate leader. So for this one, the top favorites are Mathieu van der Poel, Alejandro Valverde and Davide Formolo. But there are plenty of riders that are capable of challenging for the win, so it's going to be really hard for Rudy Mollard to try to win this one. So the riders are now departing, and most of my riders, including Mollard and Anthony Roux, are really far in the back of the peloton. I'm trying to think about what should be the best strategy, and I think I'm going to put Ladagnou in the breakaway today. It might be a good opportunity for him to try something, so let's see if I'm allowed to take him in the break today. And so I did manage to take Ladagnou in the breakaway. It wasn't really easy to create this group. We have 10 riders here, but the peloton was pacing really hard to try to bring back these riders for a long time, only now they allowed a larger gap, and we are now in the longest climb of this race. Oh, and Ladagnou has fallen. He was in the breakaway, and in the downhill he fell. It was actually when I was dropping him to get water. Oh, he's not going to be able to go back to the front, I think. He's still pretty much ahead of the peloton. Let's try to increase the pace a bit and maybe bring him back to the front. So I managed to bring Ladagnou back to the front group. He wasted a bit of energy, of course, doing that, but he's now sitting on a wheel for a while, trying to recover the energy. His yellow is already fully back, so let's hope he can still try to do something from the breakaway in this race. And so we are now 16 kilometers from the finish line. We still have Ladagnou in the front, but he's almost out of energy. Some other riders are actually attacking. Back in the main group. Oh, now I overused the effort cursor on Anthony Roux. He was pacing really hard. I don't really want to do that already. But still, Rudy Mollard is looking good. Kilian Franchini is almost out of energy. Let's actually now use Anthony Roux to protect Rudy Mollard. And I also need to use the energy gel on Ladagnou, but just maintain position at 70. If he gets dropped, I won't worry about that. Let's bring Rudy Mollard back to the front of this group. I don't want him to get dropped here. We are 10 kilometers from the finish line now, and Rudy Mollard will be alone for the remainder of the race because Anthony Roux and Ladagnou cannot do much more to help the leader of my team. So 9 kilometers still to go. Let's see. I think I need to try to attack earlier with Rudy Mollard. Let's get him to the front. The pace is really high at the moment. Still 28 riders here. And I want to try and attack where? I don't really know. Let's try the attack now. Can we do something here with Rudy Mollard? With still almost 7 kilometers to go, this attack is not really working. It was in a slightly downhill section. So, yeah, I don't really think this is going to be helpful. Let's use the energy gel on Rudy Mollard now with 5 kilometers to go. We are still in the front of the group. Let's see, 26 riders still in the front. We are pacing. Let's see, let's try to maintain Mollard at the front. He still has enough yellow to do this. So 2.7 kilometers to go now, still a slight downhill. And now we are making a left turn and going uphill now. Let's try to go at effort cursor 99 with him. And I cannot go for the sprint yet. Let's try to follow on the wheel of Mathieu van der Poel. Oh, this is wasting too much energy. And let's sprint now. I cannot take the win. It's going to be for van der Poel. Mathieu van der Poel takes the win. It was kind of predicted, actually. Schachmann is second. And Rudy Mollard finishes in a really solid seventh. So, yeah, I'm not that displeased with this result. So, Mathieu van der Poel takes his eighth win of the season. He was the strongest in the final sprint from a really select group with really strong riders. Kwiatkowski, Alejandro Valverde, also Maxi Schachmann, Dylan Tuns. And I still managed to get a 7th place with Rudy Mollard. He was not even among the top 10 favorites for this race today. So yeah, I think he overachieved in this one. And so now finally we get to our first season objective. So the sponsor wants the team to get a top 5 finish in the GC of the Paris-Nice. Of course, I'm aiming to do that with Thibaut Pinot. It's his first objective of the season as well. But it won't be an easy task. There are plenty of strong contenders for this one. We have Team Ineos with both Egan Bernal and Geraint Thomas. Also, we have Tom Dumoulin, Vincenzo Nibali. Movistar brings Richard Carapaz and Mikel Landa. Jumbo-Visma brings Steven Kruijswijk and Primoz Roglic. And besides these riders, we also have both of the Yates brothers. Also, Julien Alaphilippe, Jakob Fuglsang, Bauke Mollema, Richie Porte. So a really, really strong field for this one. Of course, I'm also bringing Arnaud Démare to Paris-Nice, and he's going to try to contend for the sprint stages, for the flat stages. There are a few of them, especially the first three, which are totally suitable for sprinters, but he will have a strong contention by Caleb Ewan, Fernando Gaviria and Peter Sagan mainly. So I'm bringing a team mainly focused on helping Thibaut Pinot to get the top 5 finish. To help Thibaut Pinot, I'm bringing Sebastian Reichenbach, Valentin Madouas, Léo Vincent, Steve Morabito. So let's get on with the race and try to win stage 1, a flat stage, with Arnaud Démare. And so we start this Paris-Nice with terrible weather today. It's raining really hard. So let's hope that there aren't many falls, especially for our team. Fortunately, Arnaud Démare is on a plus 2 race day condition today, so on a virtual 80 sprint stat. So let's see if this is going to be helpful for him in trying to win the first stage of Paris-Nice. And so now with 45 kilometers to go in the stage, we have a breakaway group with 6 riders still about 2 minutes ahead of the peloton. These were already the first ones in the previous climb and intermediate sprint. In the climb, Tom Hjelte-Slagter was the first one, and then Le Bon was the first one in the intermediate sprint. They still have 2 minutes lead over the peloton with 42 kilometers to go. Let's see if the breakaway is caught. We have Lotto Soudal now pacing in the peloton to try and prepare the way for Caleb Ewan to win the sprint. And now with 10 kilometers to go, we still have 2 riders in the front. Although Wurtz Schmidt is now out of energy, so he cannot keep up the pace. So let's start pacing now with Valentin Madouas to try to bring Guarnieri and Arnaud Démare to the front of the race. The sprint is a bit of an uphill, so let's now use the energy gel already on Valentin Madouas and pace at 90. Let's try to use our own sprint and see if this works. Energy gel now on Guarnieri. Let's increase the pace a bit more with Valentin Madouas and give the energy gel to Arnaud Démare. Let's put Madouas on 95 with 4.3 kilometers to go. Let's see, I hope this isn't too early. Let's see, let's already set Guarnieri at 99 so that he can then be launching Arnaud Démare, and soon I will start sprinting with Valentin Madouas. Let's go at 99 now and sprint with him. It's not going to be for long. Let's sprint now with Guarnieri. Oh, I think I ruined everything. Let's go now with Arnaud Démare. Can he take the win? Can Arnaud Démare take the win here? It's not going to be for him. It's Caleb Ewan taking the win. Fernando Gaviria is second and Arnaud Démare third. I think I missed it a bit because I launched the sprint with Valentin Madouas when he was already out of energy, so it didn't really work out. The riders lost a lot of speed. Well, this could have gone a bit better. Still, it's a third place. We beat Peter Sagan. Sagan is not even in the top 20. And so, by making a mistake, by launching Valentin Madouas on the sprint when he was clearly out of energy, I didn't really manage to take advantage of a strong position. My sprint train was in the front of the peloton. Arnaud Démare finishes third, so let's hope we can do better in the next one. And so the next one is again a really flat stage, and it's going to be the same thing again, basically the sprint. It's interesting that there are a few intermediate sprints really close to the finish line, so maybe actually I don't really know what the AI is going to do, but maybe they are going to sprint for that intermediate sprint and then be completely out of energy for the final sprint. And so we start another stage with torrential rain. It's really not the best conditions for the riders. We have again Arnaud Demare on a plus 2 race day condition. So let's see if this is the one where we will take a stage win. And so we are now 21.5 kilometers from the finish line, and I guess that the peloton really were careless, because the riders in the breakaway group are almost 3 minutes ahead, and no one else is pacing besides me with Steve Morabito. So 19 kilometers for the finish line, they are going to win the stage. And so there are only 6.5 kilometers to go for the riders in the breakaway. I didn't really manage to bring down the distance between the peloton and the breakaway riders. They are definitely going to win the stage with over 2 minutes lead still. I'm still anyway setting a sprint train so that Arnaud Demare can get as many points as he possibly can from the finish line for the points classification. Let's use the energy gels now on Guarnieri and Arnaud Demare. We are getting close to the finish line. Let's go at 99 with Madwa. I won't see who is going to win the stage. They are 1 kilometer now from the finish line. And now I will put Guarnieri pacing and start sprinting with him. And soon I will sprint. Yeah, the riders in the front are now finishing. And it's Mads Wurt Schmidt taking the win. And now let's launch Arnaud Demare. Can he be the first one from the breakaway? From the peloton, sorry. And no, he's second behind Caleb Ewan. So, yeah, this was a really disappointing stage. So, Mads Wurt Schmidt takes the stage win. And with this result, Cyril Gauthier is now the new leader in the GC. Tom Hjelteslagter keeps the mountain jersey. Caleb Ewan is still the leader in the points classification, 6 points ahead of Arnaud Demare in second. And the best young rider so far is Mads Wurt Schmidt. And so I wanted the stage win. I failed again, but this time everyone in the peloton failed. And so the breakaway was successful with Mads Wurt Schmidt taking the stage win. And so after kind of feeling a bit stupid because I didn't manage to bring the breakaway back in the previous stage, we now have another one that I would say that there's no way the breakaway can take this, but I would say the same thing about the previous one as well, and they did. So I really want to make sure I don't get careless in this one, and I can challenge for the stage win with Arnaud Demare. And so today we are having one of those really boring stages. It's almost 200 kilometers long, completely flat, no really big points of interest. But again, we have heavy rain, really heavy rain, tormenting the riders. And there have been a few falls, two actually, with several important riders. Steven Kruijswijk and Richard Carapaz fell even before the first intermediate sprint. A few kilometers later, Mikel Landa, Yonis Aguirre and Alexandre Genier also fell, together with the leader of the race, Cyril Gauthier. Oh, and there's another fall again with Mikel Landa and Richie Porte, and Mikel Landa is abandoning the race. What a blow for Movistar. He fell twice today and he now abandons the race. We also have Yonis Aguirre falling again and Richie Porte. Well, no surprises there. Richie Porte is falling all the time. But, well, yeah, this is kind of a blow. We have Gianluca Brambilla here to help Richie Porte to get back to the peloton. But surprisingly, they are not dropping anyone else. They still have Bauke Mollema in the peloton. So maybe Mollema is the focus of Trek Segafredo for this race. So now with roughly 40 kilometers to go in the stage, we have basically Lotto Soudal and Team Emirates pacing at the front of the peloton to bring back the riders in the breakaway. We have now Samuel Dumoulin attacking. He's trying to go alone to the finish line. It's not going to be easy. There are still 35 kilometers to go. We have other riders trying to work a bit in this breakaway group, but there's no way they are going to survive the pace put in the peloton. And so we are now 14 kilometers from the finish line. The pace put in by Team Emirates and Lotto Soudal is absolutely insane. I already set my sprint train for Arnaud Demare, but it's not being easy to get to the front of the race. We now caught the riders in the breakaway, so let's try to start increasing the pace a bit to be in the front of the peloton. I don't want Arnaud Demare to be stuck behind other riders. There's another fall. Simon Yates and Miguel Angel Lopez have fallen. Let's see, they are still going to continue in the race. Let's go back to the front and start using these energy gels here and increase the pace with Leo Vincent. I need to prepare the sprint properly. Let's go at 88 for now. And soon, well, let's increase the pace to 90 already and use several of the energy gels now. Soon I will do the same with Arnaud Demare. Let's increase the pace even more now with Leo Vincent to 95 and energy gel on Arnaud Demare. Let's go all out with Leo Vincent now. And soon it will be Steve Morabito pacing. Let's go with Morabito now and try to put Vincent in the back. Arnaud Demare is a bit behind. This is not looking spectacular at the moment. Let's now start pacing with Valentin Madouas. And I will start the sprint with him. And soon let's launch Guarnieri now and Arnaud Demare, and I cannot see anything. Can I take the stage win? No, it's going to be Caleb Ewan again. Caleb Ewan ahead of Arnaud Demare and Hodge. And Jacopo Guarnieri was fourth. I was a bit confused in the end with the fog. But still, it wasn't a bad result with Demare. But again, Caleb Ewan was the strongest. So Caleb Ewan is once more the strongest in the sprint. He beats Arnaud Demare. In the GC, Cyril Gauthier still holds on to his lead. There were, of course, no changes in the mountain classification today, with no points available. Tom Hjelte-Slachter is still the leader. Caleb Ewan increases his lead in the points classification a bit more over Arnaud Demare after this one. And there were also no changes in the young rider classification, with Mads Wurtschmidt still leading. And so it's another podium finish for Arnaud Demare in this Paris-Nice. It's not a win, but well, actually I'm not that disappointed. This is actually a stage where I'm glad I survived with all my riders, because in the end, Richie Porte lost 9 minutes in the GC. He never managed to get back to the front after falling. Also, Daniel Martinez lost a lot of time, Yannis Aguirre the same, and even worse, Mikel Landa abandoned after this stage. And so with this one, I will finish this episode. Unfortunately, I didn't manage any win today, but I got a few solid results, especially in Omloop Het Nieuwsblad, where Marc Sarre was third. In the next episode, I will continue Paris-Nice and start the Tirreno Adriatico. I won't finish any of the races in that episode. Combining both of the races, there are still 12 stages to finish both of them. So I think I will split them into two episodes. Possibly I will ride 6 stages per episode, but maybe I can go for 7 in the next one and leave 5 for the following episode, which will have the conclusion of both races. So I hope you guys have enjoyed this one, even though the results weren't the best I could have. I would also love to have your feedback on my series. Please comment below and tell me what you enjoy the most and the least in this series. Also, if you haven't subscribed to my channel yet, I would really appreciate if you do that. And so, I hope to see you all soon for the next episode of my Groupama FDJ career in Pro Cycling Manager. Bye!